Welcome back. I said to you before, we're going to look at the lube system and cleaning out the back and the swarf from the rear of the Y axis in the casting on the machine.
And I've removed the oil lube panel, and this is the mess we got, excuse me, behind here. So not uncommon on these Haas that this area just fills with swarf and makes a hell of a mess. You've got a drain off the back here, which is down in there, again, built up with a lot of swarf. And you want to keep this area clear because any coolant that runs down the back will come into here. This has got the oil coolant separator where the oil goes into a pot. Pot didn't come with it, but you could put any pot there. And then where the oil floats and skims off the top, and then the coolant can run back to the back of the back into the coolant tank. Now, this is the only machine I've had. I've got this on both my machines, but I've never had it come with this tube, which is good, because it's hard to get a flexi line to not droop in the middle and not empty out properly. So yeah, we've removed everything. We're gonna give that a good clean, because as you can see, that's a bit of a mess. This oil line here I cut, just because I took it all off, and when you're one-handed, it's easy to just snip it and then put it back in. So let me show you the oil panel. Air oil panel, we've cleaned this up. We took this off here. I said before, we removed the filter from here, and what I wanted to do was just check that none of these lines are blocked. So the simplest way that I normally do that is I'll remove this, and rather than doing every line, I can just put my air gun in the center of that there, and this is going to put back pressure in it to the gauge. You can see there. So we're clear between the gauge and there. Now I already cycled the pump, so I know that the pump is clear into here, so that's not an issue. So that side of it we already proved was good. And then what you can also do, which is what I've done, and I couldn't film it, I probably could have, but I didn't because I was one-handed, is that I haven't disconnected all this line, but this one here comes into here, splits off and comes back out. This goes to your lube system on the machine. So that splits off to XYZ. This one here has got a metering unit, and then this is the feed for your spindle, and this is the air feed for the spindle, which should bypass a set amount of air to the spindle, and the oil should basically, over a set period of time, the metering unit should only allow so much through. So it's different to the drip feed of the newer machines, which look to be much better, to be honest, but they're very expensive to upgrade. I looked into it, and it was about £2,000 to just do the air oiler setup for the spindle. I suppose it's not expensive in comparison to the cost of a new spindle if you have to buy one, but this does work if you maintain it. So yeah, what I also done was just put air into there, and I'm not going to be able to show you, but basically it comes out of that there. So at least just on this part, I know that this line's clear, and I know that this is clear in here. I'm not sure about the spindle line yet, so what I'll do is when I put this back on and cleaned everything up, I'll run this hose into a bottle, run the spindle at 50 RPM for a couple of hours, and I should at least collect a few drops of oil. As long as we see a few drops of oil, we know we're working. If we don't see any oil, then we know we've got an issue, and I'll look further at this piece here. But now it's clean, and all the swarf's gone. I've checked everything's plugged in properly. Now it's clean, cleaned all the gum off the bottom of here, but I haven't got a new filter pad for there, but it is relatively clean. Cleaned out the tank. Once I put that back on, if I need to take it off to do anything else, it's easy now because it's not covered in gunk and dirt. So when we want to do that, pretty straightforward. So I'm now going to go get this put back on. Actually, I'm going to leave this on the bench here. I'm going to get Freddy coolant and swarf vacuum, and I'm going to get involved and clean out the back of that. So once I've given that a good clean, I'll bring you back in a second to show you what it's like. Okay, so we've spent the last couple of hours cleaning this out. We haven't cleaned up the mess on the floor yet, but you can see we've cleaned in there as best as we can without removing the motor and all that side of it. So I'm not going to get into actually removing the motor, but we've got the majority of the chips and the swarf and all the gunk away, so it's a little bit clean. We can see what we're doing now. I've pressurized these oil lines and they do seem to be creeping down a little bit from what I can tell. So before we get into removing the oil line to each axis to make sure it's working or see what's blocked, I'm going to plumb it back in as it is. I've just cable tied up the limit switches there because one of them was about a meter too long. And basically we'll plug it all back in as it is now it's clean. We'll run the machine up, we'll run the fill the oil up, and we'll see how it goes. We'll see if it pressurizes and we'll see if the pressure actually drops. Someone mentioned about not using the Vactra oil, which I don't in my machines now. This is one of Haas's alternative oils that they recommend to use now in the lube systems, in the old Bijur oil pump systems. So I use that in the VF3, my VF0E. I've used that in the last machine I sold, and I put it in everything basically, regards to Haas, and I also removed them little stone filters. So yeah, if anyone wondered what I'm using for oil, that's what I use. And it doesn't create that horrible sticky mess in the bottom of the pumps, the bottom of the pumps and in the lines like the old Vactra 2 used to. So yeah, let's get the oil and lube panel, the air panel put back on. We'll fill it up and we'll see if we can get it working. Okay, so that's the air lube panel refit to the machine. All nice and clean. Gonna top this up now, and what I did do was the main line between the back feed into the machine, I replaced it so it's longer, because what you find is when you unbolt this and you try and take it down, that line's too short and you end up hanging on it. So I've done it on the other machines as well. I replace it with a bit that's about 2 foot longer, and then you can, when you unbolt this and everything else is unplugged, you can take it and put it straight down onto the floor. So that's all cleaned up. So let's have a little tidy up here. We'll fill this up with a mobile one and then we'll cycle the machine and we'll see if it works. If it doesn't work then and it's still holding the pressure, then obviously the actual lines themselves are blocked and it must be on more than one axis. Otherwise you would have thought the pressure would drop. So let's fill it up and cycle it and see what happens. Okay, so the machine's now running at 50 RPM. Just in MDI there, probably run it a bit slower than that if you want. So it's got tooling the spindle. That way, like I said, when I was running it the other day and I've run it in previous days, warm-up cycles, I manually put a couple of drops of the oil into the airline that goes to the spindle, just so you know you're not running it dry, because I don't know how long this machine actually realistically sat for before I got it, and it's been here about a month now. So you want to make sure you've got some oil to the spindle, but not too much. So I haven't tied it up yet. I just wanted to show you that we've got a bit of pressure in here. Now, what I want to see is I want to see that drop. Currently, it's not moving, so I still think there could be a bit of a blockage. We've got our spindle lube line there, and we've got air to that. So all we need to do is make sure that we're getting oil to it, but it's very hard to see. But I'm just going to try and see if I can zoom in there. So if you look here, you can just see drips of oil getting blown along that line, and that's all that happens for your spindle lube. So you can see we are getting a bit of oil. It's so hard to see, and that's how minimalistic the air oil system is on these spindles. So there's not much. If things go wrong and you lose that oil, that's when your spindle goes bad pretty quickly. So you do want to make sure. I think the way to tell properly by the book is you disconnect this line you run it into a bottle. You can't do it at the spindle end because it's very difficult unless you take the torque release piston assembly off to actually do it in the bottle at the top end, because obviously if you do it at the actual end of the spindle, then you're going to know there's no kinks and no blockages and you're getting it the end you need to. But if you just want to make sure the main end is doing what it should do, you can disconnect it here and run a line into a bottle and see if you get some drops of oil. So we've got pressure here, but like I said, I don't think that's actually going down now. I think it's built up pressure and it is now staying there. Now what I've done when I connected this lot back up, so this is the line I said that I made new and I extended so I can lift this whole lot away from it without this getting pulled tight, is I disconnect this from the T-piece just in there, and then from that bit there I'll then pump this until it bleeds through, because if not you can have a load of air in the system. So regardless of what happens here now, I know that we're good from the pump to the backside fitting and going out to the spindle. Looks like it's working okay. Obviously it's not blocked because that's just a big airline. So we're good to that T-piece. So if there's any issues after that, what I'll need to be doing is disconnecting each line to the T-piece, and I might block them off one at a time to see what happens. Obviously your X and your Y go in one direction and your Z is going to go up in the other direction. So you could cap off the line to the Z to see if X and Y are blocked, but the fact that it's blocked from beyond that point, I'd say that they're both gummed up, or all three of them are gummed up. So I think we're going to have to look into that further, but I'm going to run this for a while and just see what happens and then go from there. So I will bring you back shortly. Okay, so I've left it long enough to confirm that the pressure in the lube system was not going down. The pressure was staying, the pump was activating. You could hear the pump click when it cycled, and the pump went right round to about 20 psi. And then on the second click, it went to about 40, and that's where it stayed for around an hour, hasn't moved. We've also run this the spindle line into this bottle for about an hour, and there isn't a single drop of oil in there. So let's disconnect that. So easiest one to get to, I come down here and I disconnected at this junction here to see what would happen. And lo and behold, disconnect here, oil comes out, pressure drops. So now we know that we're there and that's okay. We move across and I've undone these two lines and I disconnected just one side off on the other side of the metering unit. No oil come out from the metering unit, so I disconnected the metering unit and oil splurged out. Now, basically that just tells you that the metering units are clogged up. So if you can look at that in the end there, and look how badly that is filled up with gunk. And I'm going to try and get something to have a look and pick that out of. I said I was going to tidy up my bench and I still haven't done it, which makes this a little bit more awkward. But let's try and, I definitely should have tied it up before starting this video. But let's just get a little tiny pick tool and just see how solid the gunk is in the end of these fittings. Try and do this whilst holding the camera. So you can see there that is just, again, it's congealed, feels like grease. I've not come across anything like this on the few machines that I've dealt with so far, but it's definitely like it's been packed with grease. Let me try and prop the phone up with something and then I'll be able to use two hands. So you can see there. Feels like a grease, but it's probably just congealed oil, been in there a long time, built up, causing the issue. Now, you're not going to clean these out, not now. They're past that stage, I would have thought. So it's a case of replacing these. Now, I've only so far tested that one on the X-axis, but if one's like it, it means they're all going to be like it, and that goes to show why the lube system, the lube system is not working. It's cycling, it's building pressure, but the oil cannot go anywhere, and you'll probably find that all, you've got five of these per axis, so you have one to each truck on the linear rails on the X, Y, and Z, and you also have one to each ball screw. And then you have another one for the oil mist for the spindle. So you've got 16 of these to change. And they're about, I can't remember the price, but when you've got to buy 16 of them and a few fittings and bits and pieces, you could probably spend a few hundred quid. But at the end of the day, it's things like this are the reason probably why it's got a noisy ball screw on the X. And surprised it isn't bad in the spindle and the rest of them, considering they're so blocked up. So we're going to have to get these on order because I don't have any in stock. Normally I do keep a few, but I've used them. So I'll have to order these, and we're going to have to strip each axis, which is a pain. I'm not going to lie, it's quite difficult getting to some of them. Some aren't so bad, some are quite difficult. And also it's quite difficult to not get leaks. If you watch one of my old videos, I had a nightmare with the Z-axis on one machine, kept weeping around the fittings into the trucks. So yeah, we'll change these. I'm going to call that the end of this video for the minute. So we've solved the problem as such. We know what the lube system is doing now. We've cleaned up the back panel, and we cleaned out all the chips and all the rubbish behind the guards, and we basically need to just refresh the oil system. So I'll get these on order, and in the next video, hopefully, I'll have them all replaced and I'll be able to show you the lube system working properly. So cheers for watching. We'll see you again soon.